सर स्क्रीन शेयर हो रही है मेरी?
जी जी बिल्कुल आ रही है, करें स्टार्ट।
ठीक है सर। अस्सलाम वालेकुम, आई एम डॉक्टर ताहा मलिक, पीजी ट्रेनी एनेस्थीसिया, सीबीआईसी मुल्तान। टुडे द टॉपिक ऑफ माय डिस्कशन इज एनेस्थीसिया मैनेजमेंट ऑफ पेशेंट्स विद द पेरिकार्डियल डिजीज एंड पेसमेकर। सो फर्स्ट आई विल स्टार्ट विद द पेसमेकर। So what is basically a pacemaker? It's a medical device which generates electrical impulse through electrodes to contract the heart muscles to regulate the beating of heart. The parts of pacemaker. The pacemaker components includes the implantable pulse generator, the electrodes. The implantable pulse generator contains a power source which is called the battery and a circuitry that controls the pacemaker operations. The leads are insulated wires that and leads also transmit electrical signals from the heart to the pulse generator. The electrodes are basically the conductor located at the end of the lead and deliver the impulse to the heart. So here in the picture we can see the pacemaker. It has a lead and anode and a cathode. What are the types of pacemakers? Pacemakers are of three types. These are the temporary pacemakers, implantable cardioverter defibrillators, and permanent pacemakers. Temporary pacemakers are external. They are battery powered pulse generators and are used for bradycardia or tachyarrhythmias, and they are used for less than 3 days. It includes transvenous pacing, epicardial pacing, transcutaneous pacing, esophageal pacing, and that we use in our cardiac surgery directly connected to the heart. Uski leads jo hoti hain wo directly connected to the heart after cardiac surgery. Usme hum pacemaker outside the heart attach karte hain, hamari leads jo hoti hain wo directly attached hoti hain. Implantable detection and therapy. Its uses include anti-tachycardia, anti-bradycardia pacing, synchronized cardioversion shock, non-synchronized defibrillation shock, and it is also used for diagnostic purpose. Its indications include initial therapy in survivors of tachycardia and in patients with syncope and who are hemodynamically unstable and have sustained VT or VFib. Now the permanent pacemakers, these are implantable pulse generator with the endocardial and myocardial electrodes for long term and permanent use. The indications of its use are SA node disease, AV node disease, hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, dilated cardiomyopathy, and long QT syndrome. So what does a basically pacemaker do? It basically paces the heart and then sends the heart. Pacing is sending an electric current to the heart with the resulting propagation of wave of depolarization throughout the chamber. And sensing is the response of the pacemaker to intrinsic heartbeats, and that measures the voltage produced by the heart when it contracts. So there are some important terms in the mechanism of action of pacemaker. These are the pacing threshold, capture rate response, triggered pacing, and inhibition of the output. So these are the codes basically. Here we can see the codes consist of 4 or 5 numbers. The first position is the pacing chamber, matlab it represents the pacing chamber. The second digit presents the sensing chamber, and the third digit presents the what it did with the sensing information. So the pacing chambers, it could be zero, that means none. It could be in the atrium, it could be in the ventricle, or it could be dual, that is its presence in the atrium as well as ventricle. The sensing chamber could be also like that of the pacing chamber. The response to sensing could be none, or it could be inhibited, or it could be triggered, or both. On position 4, there is programmability, or this could be none, or programmable, or multi-programmable, communicating, or rate modulation. The position 5, it is very advanced and we don't use it over here, but it includes anti-tachycardia functions, that is none, pacing, shock, and dual. So for understanding, we can see here, these are basically the types of pacemakers that have the codes. For example, the last codes DDD. So what does it mean? The letter at the first position represents the area that is paced. The letter at the second position represents the area which is sensed. And the letter at the third position, this is the, for example, if the code is AOO, it means that atrium is being paced with no sense and no inhibitions. For example, in AAI, it means atria is paced, atria is sensed, and it is inhibited by the atrium. In position VOO, it's same like ventricle pacing, no sense, no inhibition. When VVI, ventricular pacing, ventricular sensing, and ventricular inhibition. DVI, dual pacing, ventricular sensing, and ventricular inhibition. And DDD means dual pacing, dual sensing, and dual inhibition. So I want to explain these terms, that what is pacing threshold. Pacing threshold is basically the minimum output of energy that pacemaker sends down the lead to initiate the heartbeat. This is basically the pacing threshold. And what is capture? Capture is the cardiac depolarization and resultant contraction of atria or ventricular that is caused by the pacemaker stimulus. Rate response, various sensors that pacemakers have various sensors that activate during the patient while he's doing activity, and it adjusts the rate accordingly. Triggered pacing means dual chamber pacemaker can be programmed to sense activity in one chamber, that is maybe in atrium, or deliver pacing stimulus in other chamber like ventricle after a certain time delay. Then there is inhibition of the output. It is basically a work of the pacemaker that is programmed to inhibit pacing if it sends intrinsic or the intrinsic activity of the heart and deliver pacing stimulus regardless of the heart activity. So there are four basically modes of the pacing. First is asynchronous pacing or fixed rate pacing. It includes three codes, AOO, VOO, and DOO. Single chamber or demand pacing. It includes AAI, VVI, discharge at a present rate only when the spontaneous heart rate drops below the present rate. Dual chamber AV sequential pacing, it in the atrium is stimulated to contract first and then ventricle is stimulated. And then the programmable pacemakers. So here in the picture we can see single chamber. In single chamber, the lead is only in the right ventricle. In dual chamber, the right atrium is also sensed and right ventricle is also sensed and based. Milliamperes value wo set kar sakte. और नीचे हमारा ये ऊपर हमारा लॉ है और इमरजेंसी में हम लोग ये एसिंक्रोनस जो है वो कर देते हैं, बटन प्रेस कर देते हैं, तो इररिस्पेक्टिव ऑफ द हार्ट तो ये पेसमेकर जो है वो उसको पेस करता है हार्ट को. सो व्हाट आर द बेसिकली प्री ऑपरेटिव कंसर्न्स अबाउट द पेशेंट्स विद पेसमेकर. फर्स्ट वी विल इवैल्यूएट द पेशेंट दैट व्हाट वाज द अंडरलाइंग कार्डियोवास्कुलर डिजीज दैट वाज रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर द associated illness like coronary artery disease, hypertension or diabetes mellitus, severity of the cardiac disease, current functional status of the patient and the medical status of the patient. Then evaluation of the pacemaker, that what is the type of the pacemaker, is it a fixed rate or a demand rate? What is the physical examination of the patient? Is there any significant finding? Half-life of the pacemaker battery, effect of magnet on the pacemaker, that we'll discuss in the next slides. Time since implantation and pacemaker rate at the time of implantation. Investigations that we do are routine investigations like CBC, RFTs, serum electrolytes are important, chest X-ray and ECG. Preoperative preparation include determined any electromagnetic interference. If there is a likelihood of any interference, then we reprogram the cardiac rhythm management device and suspend anti-tachyarrhythmia function. Determine normality if present. Changes baseline electrolytes and hemodynamically should be stable. Heart rate, rhythm, hypertension, coronary ischemia, because it can change the cardiovascular implantable electronic devices function and its adverse effects on the patient outcome. Narcotics plus inhalational can be used. We should avoid nitrous oxide because it can cause expansion of gas in the pacemaker pocket. Etomidate and ketamine should be avoided because they cause myoclonic movements, so it can disturb the activity of the pacemaker. Pacemaker function should be verified before initiating mechanical ventilation, as a positive pressure ventilation can dislodge pacemaker leads. Skeletal myopotentials, electroconvulsive therapy, succinylcholine fasciculations, myoclonic movements, direct muscle stimulation can inappropriately inhibit or trigger stimulation depending on programmed pacing modes. Care should be taken during insertion of guide wire or central venous catheter, as are arrhythmogenic and they can dislodge the pacemaker leads. The monitoring include the ECG, non-invasive blood pressure, and tidal carbon dioxide and temperature. Electrical and mechanical evidence of heart function should be monitored by manual palpation of pulse, pulse oximetry, and precordial stethoscope and ANN. Now, the effect of electromagnetic interference. The pacing may cause asynchronous pacing. It can reset to backup mode. It can cause myocardial burn or ventricular fibrillation. Now, the measures to decrease the adverse effects of electromagnetic interference are, we should use bipolar cautery or ultrasonic harmonic scalpel. Unipolar cautery, if you are using, then the grounding should be placed close the operative site and as far as away as possible from the site of pacemaker. Electrocautery should not be used within 15 cm of the pacemaker, and pacemaker should be programmed to asynchronous mode by a magnet or by a drugs like isoproterenol and atropine should be available. We should do careful monitoring and should recheck the device after operation. When there is a greater risk of stray currents from cautery, then ICD should have defibrillator function programmed off immediately before surgery and reprogrammed back on immediately afterwards. अगर हम इसको नहीं करेंगे ऑफ तो जो हमारा implantable cardioverter defibrillator है तो वो जैसे ही कोई current detect करेगा तो उसको लगेगा कि ये अब patient को shock देना है, कोई arrhythmias हो रहे हैं कुछ भी, तो patient को फिर वो shock दे देगा. तो इसलिए हमने उसको पहले जो है वो off करना है और फिर जैसे ही हमारी surgery complete होगी तो हमने उसको again on करना है. और इस दौरान हमारे पास जो है वो we should have a defibrillator or cardioverter by the side of our table. ताकि अगर पेशेंट को जरूरत पड़े तो हम उसी वक्त उसको फ्रॉम द एक्सटर्नल साइड जो है वो प्रोवाइड कर दें. मैग्नेट एप्लीकेशन. मैग्नेट बेसिकली इज प्लेस्ड ओवर द पल्स जनरेटर एंड इट ट्रिगर रीड स्विच. नॉन सिंक्रोनस, इट्स सेंसिंग नॉन सेंसिंग एसिंक्रोनस मोड एंड fixed pacing rate, that is the magnet rate. It shut down the demand function and protects pacemaker dependent patients during EMI such as diathermy or electrocautery. The specific perioperative conditions are in the procedures that includes electroconvulsive therapy, radiation, nerve stimulator testing, lithotripsy, and MRI. Postoperative care includes cardiac rate and rhythm monitoring. Shivering and fasciculations should be avoided. Backup pacing capability, cardioversion defibrillation equipment should be available. Restore all anti-tachy arrhythmic therapies in ICDs. We should consult a cardiologist and assure that other settings of our devices are fine. Now we come to the topic of pericardial diseases. First of all, we will recall the anatomy of the pericardium. It includes two layers, that are visceral pericardium and parietal pericardium. The visceral pericardium is a single layer of mesothelial cells, and the parietal pericardium is fibrous and is less than 2 mm thick layer. The function of pericardium is to limit the motion, prevent dilatation during volume increase, and barrier to infection. This is basically the pericardium. It has a fibrous pericardium and a serous pericardium, and the pericardial fluid in between. acute pericarditis. Acute pericarditis can be caused by infections that could be viral, bacterial, or by tuberculosis, and non-infectious that occurs in post-MI, uremia, neoplastic diseases, post-radiation, and drug abuse. It could be due to connective tissue disease or autoimmune or traumatic. It is basically the inflammatory process. In this, the vasodilation occurs that causes the increased vascular permeability and the leukocyte exudation. And types can include serous, serofibrinous, purulent, and hemorrhagic that could be due to TB or malignancy. The clinical presentation of the patient is we can find out the symptoms like chest pain radiates towards back and is sharp and pleuritic in nature. It is positional and worse on lying back. Patient presents with fever, dyspnea due to pain, malaise, and myalgias. And on physical examination, there will be a frictional rub. Diagnosis can be made by clinical history, ECG, that could be sometimes non-specific or may show diffuse ST elevation and PR depression. Echocardiography will show effusion. We can also check autoimmune antibodies to rule out any autoimmune cause. And we should also evaluate the patient for malignancy. This is the picture of ECG carditis with widespread ST elevation. We can see the ST elevation, diffuse ST elevation in all leads. Preclude NSAIDs, colchicine, steroids, and for tuberculosis, we give ATT. If it is purulent, then drainage and antibiotics. If it is neoplastic, then again drainage. And if it is uremic, then dialysis. Now, anesthesia concerns include the hemodynamic. We have to check the patient if he's hemodynamic instability. Then we will be careful about the drugs that also cause hypotension and further cardiac output decline. Elective surgery should be postponed in unstable patients, and pericardiectomy should be performed in constrictive pericarditis before major surgery. In emergencies, we can do volume expansion. We can give catecholamines. Anesthetics like ketamine should be given as it can increase the cardiac output or systemic resistance. Elective surgery should be postponed till causative disorder has been stabilized and pericarditis has been resolved. Chronic pericarditis is the pericarditis that remain for more than 3 months, and preoperative and perioperative management depends upon the hemodynamic impact. We will see the volume of the pericardial effusion. If it is moderate to large, then it should be drained before surgery. And it always presents with recurrent and relapse of the pericarditis. Symptomatic treatment also. Now the pericardial effusion. Pericardial effusion can be caused by acute pericarditis or hypothyroidism that also increases the capillary permeability, congestive heart failure because it increases the hydrostatic pressure, osmotic pressure, chylous effusion that is due to lymphatic obstruction, and including that section. Clinical presentation may be asymptomatic, or patient may present with chest pain, dyspnea, dysphagia, hoarseness, or hiccups. On examination, we find out absence of rub and a back striate that includes hypotension, engorged neck veins, and muffled heart sounds. Diagnosis can be made with the chest X-ray that will show cardiomegaly. On ECG, we will have low voltage ECG and echocardiography. We should treat the underlying cause, which is causing the pericardial effusion. And if unknown, then pericardiocentesis or pericardial window is the JVD, hypotension, quiet heart, sinus tachycardia, and pulsus paradoxus. Compression in echocardiography, we will find cardiac surgery and cardiac catheterization. Effusion may lead to tamponade, and it will cause impaired LV and RV filling. It will increase systolic venous pressure, decrease stroke volume, and decrease cardiac output, and there will be pulsus paradoxus. The trigger for a cardiac tamponade could be hypovolemia, paroxysmal tachycardia, and intercurrent acute pericarditis. muffled heart sounds, the standard jugular vein, and hypotension. And others include tachycardia, narrow pulse pressure, dyspnea, cyanosis, restlessness, and eventually shock. The diagnosis is mostly clinical or chest tamponade. Because cardiac tamponade is an emergency, so urgent pericardial drainage should be done under local anesthesia with volume infusion. Hypoxia can be treated with 100% oxygen, and if needed, then we can intubate the patient and while preparing for the pericardiocentesis. But we should avoid prolonged positive pressure ventilation because it can further decrease the cardiac output. And it can even worsen the condition. So we should avoid diuretics, and diuretics can be given after the drainage of the fluid. Anesthesia choice, if the pericardial fluid is not drained, then ketamine can be given for induction and maintenance as it increases heart rate. And alternative to this is benzodiazepines plus nitrous oxide maintenance plus fentanyl with pancuronium for skeletal muscle relaxation. We should monitor the invasive blood pressure with A-line, central venous line, and tidal carbon dioxide should be monitored, saturation and ECG should be monitored. Post-op care of patients with cardiac tamponade include the monitoring of the blood pressure, because these patients go from severe hypotension to severe hypertension, and these hypertensive patients can be treated with, especially those who have the cause of aortic dissection, chest trauma, or coronary perforation during angioplasty. Are infrequent but general anesthesia. Pre-operative, perioperative care is challenging due to hemodynamics to avoid serious perioperative and post-operative. Those that I put in this presentation, these will be very helpful.